very own teachers and friends to the Alumni Speak program facilitated by the Office of Alumni Relations. I must mention Nawabzada Bin Jung, an alumnus of the 1979 batch, a former Indian cricketer who played first-class cricket from 1978 to 1984. He is now a conservationist, an author, and runs the Royal Migration Camps in Serengeti, Tanzania, while his children manage the bison in South India. I have been fortunate enough to listen to his talks yesterday, and his humble and humane traits have really impressed me. He believes in being an Indian first and considers failure a part of success and not its opposite. The pandemic is a self-explanatory example of his ideology that when man tries to become God, it results in chaos. His skill to tickle the minds of the audience so that they themselves answer the questions that arise in their mind is truly amazing. He has written 3 books, all with conservation themes. Wild Tales from the Wild, Sugan and I, My Adventure with the Angling Legend of India, and a novel, Mata Beli Tom, a thriller set in Africa and India. Here, we have a lifetime occasion where you are face to face with a gentleman who is not only courageous in his actions, but also thoughtful and insightful leader who is here to make us peep into a world that he has closely observed. A very warm welcome, sir, and we're all excited and looking forward to an amazing session full of learning experiences with you on the theme Wildlife Conservation and Us.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. And thank you to the students for being here. One of the fundamentals of this session today is not just an old man sitting in front of you and talking some rubbish. That I will do, that's my prerogative of being an old school boy and I can get away with it. But about someone who's trying to make a difference to each of your lives. About someone who's actually spent over 40 years in a very tough and unforgiving environment, in a place, in a world where there are no thank yous, in a place, in a world where the people do not even have basic amenities, like they've never seen blankets, they've never seen mattresses, they've never seen spoons, plates, two times food, meat. No, basic amenities have been missing. And here is someone who comes out of one of the best, I think, schools in the world and goes down to the very foundation or 70% of our country and sees failure. Now, there are 2 ways of handling failure, like she was saying. The first fundamental of failure is that it is a step for success. That you take failure and you say, no, it's a learning process. And the second method is that you take failure and you push it under the carpet and you say, to hell with it, he's failed, kick him out of here. And I'm going to be extremely frank and open with you. One of the best lessons that I've learned in life was in the school. Not one, 4 lessons. Right, the reason I keep saying thank you to the board, to the alumni institution, and to the faculty, and to Colonel Saab, is the fact that they have given us an opportunity, given me an opportunity to be a part of something which is very difficult, very contentious. The meaning of contentious is something which people do not want to hear, do not want to be a part of. And for a school of this magnitude, with so many different traditions and so many different cultures and such amazing history, to actually give us an opportunity to discuss those difficult failures of our society is amazing. It's absolutely amazing. No school has done it. Since 1947, I don't think any school has allowed anyone of my position as a conservationist to stand in front of you and to tell you the truth. All right, the truth is my perspective. The truth is always your personal perspective. Your truth will never be my truth. So there is a difference there. So today I'm going to give you my truth, my learning from 40 years of experience. And for allowing me to stand here, Mr. Reddy, ma'am, sir, thank you very much. And you students, thank you, girls and boys, thank you for being here. Be vigilant, yes, we've taught to be vigilant. About what? And what does it mean? And how does it influence life? And how does it affect your own position in society? Well, some of the learnings that I've had, the biggest learnings, have been here with Mr. Reddy as my mate in class, sitting next to me. He was not only my schoolmate, my teammate, but also on the same table we used to sit. Now, when we were part of the school for 12 years, one of the first things that I learned, without even knowing I'm learning it, is I was an Indian. At home, I was not an Indian. I'm sorry. Terrible thing to say. I was not an Indian first. At home, I was this family, this sect, that caste, this religion. Go there, say, do this. You'll get punished if you don't do this. You are this. I didn't want to be that. It's because I was born there. Didn't mean that I wanted to be that. No. And when I came here, I was told, you be yourself. And that, my friends, is the most amazing learning that any school will give you. So we were, when we throughout our journey in school, we were Indian first. I'll get into details of how that affects conservation. Affects it in a very, very big way. So I won't do it now, but I'll get to it later. Because one of the main critical issues when you start conserving this world is you will go down to the village and there you will find that they are not Indian first. A lot of other barriers are coming in their life which are stopping them from sitting on the same table as me, as the other villagers, and talking together to get a win-win situation. And conservation is nothing but trying to get a win-win situation where everybody wins. Humans, animals, the whole eco-biosphere, every living creature, all of us have to be taken together on the same platform. And then solutions find. Find solutions for us. Find solutions for a human. Where do I get my basic food from? I know villages where mothers put rocks in water and serve it as soup because they don't have money. So I know villagers who would come to me and steal all my bed sheets and blankets and spoons and food. But they were, so I said, don't steal it, just take it. As people who are part of your village, it's my right to actually give you those. So I've tried to find that win-win solution, and when trying to find that win-win solution, I've actually come up against a lot of heartburn. I think we've won in a lot of places, but we've also lost a lot. Now, education. What is education? Now, in this school, I realize that education is a journey. It's not that degree that you get. You can be an aeronautical engineer. But the journey of getting to become that aeronautical engineer from your KG, from your school, from your pre-primary, primary, to school, to higher school, to college, to your engineering, those 20 years of your life, what you have learned there, what you have absorbed in your heart, what are the friends you've made, the sort of man that you are, or the woman that you've been, that is education. So when you're faced with something, a crisis, your degree is not going to help. It's that education. And this school taught me that the 12 best years of my life was that journey. Because that final education, that final degree or that final ISC certificate that I wanted to get sitting behind Mr. Reddy, I didn't get. I failed. So am I a failure? When I came to Mr. Dutt, who was my principal, when I went to my classmates, we partied that night. Mr. Reddy is right here. We had a hell of a time. I mean, I was of course upset for no reason because I didn't know what that meant. For 2 years of my life, I was not in school, I was playing cricket. I was playing international cricket against the West Indies, Australia. I played against Pakistan when I was in school, maybe your age. So I didn't know what chemistry meant. So Mr. Dutt told me that this is the biggest learning of your life. And Mr. Dutt actually hugged me in the principal's office on the right. And my boys who left me and went to college, they never left me. They were all part of me. And they were there for me all my life. The biggest learning of my life was that 12 years I spent here. So I didn't get my IC. I got another certificate. I passed my 12th next year. Am I a failure? There are two ways of looking at failure. One is there should be zero fear of failure, which I was taught in this school. But at home, you fail, you get a slap. Part of government, you fail, you get transferred. And which is one of the main fundamentals of the problems that we have in conservation? The fact that we are frightened of failure. If you're frightened of failure, all the causes that are making you fail are hidden, are put away. To win, you have to learn to lose first. You have to accept and embrace losing, because losing is the fundamental of success. You will never know how to win if you don't know how to be a loser. You have to learn from your losses. I'm going to take you through a video. All of you, that's why I gave you a little talk before that. See it, some of you might not like the things you see. But at the end of the day, there are two worlds that you're going to see in this video. One is very beautiful and one is really bad. I mean, like horrible. Have a look. And at the end of that, then let us talk a little on conservation. I'm not going to spend a long time on conservation like I did yesterday. I'm going to be spending time with careers, how you can use this opportunity of conservation today to actually embrace it as a career move. How you can be part of the world of conservation. Okay? Lights off. Take a second. Yeah, just put on the lights. That light you can keep, but the rest you can. If you can. Otherwise, you don't see it. Yeah. Thank you. Who lives and we must dictate who dies. Who's given us that? Who's given us that the power? We are not God. We can only destroy. We cannot create. So I'm going to tell you a quick story about this whole operation of culling, killing of elephants. That operation which is taking place, killing of elephants is called culling. Culling is where man turns around and says, culling is where man turns around and plays God and says, I will decide how many animals of a particular species can live in this world. But it's not these poor animals which are destroying anything, it's us humans. Why don't you decide how many of us should live in this world? And when man plays God, the world suffers. And all of you know, you must have read about global warming, etc., etc., how we're destroying the world. So one of the objectives of coming here today is to find out solutions where we can stop destroying this world. So let me take you to a quick story on culling operation in Kruger. Culling is a tool for conservation, according to countries like South Africa, Namibia, and earlier it used to be Botswana. I think they changed the laws. But these countries believe that you must kill animals in order to ensure that a certain limited amount of animals remain. Kruger National Park is a very long park, very long park. It's in South Africa. You can see on the right, it's a very long park. And in the park, a helicopter will fly. It will drive the poor elephants who are screaming and shouting and crying and terrified towards a line of hunters. And the hunters will shoot every single one of those elephants, from the little calf to the big mother, to the matriarch, to the old lady, everything. Why do you shoot them all? Oh, because there will be trauma. Okay. If that's what you believe, then fine. And that's they're doing it. But they didn't stop there. They said, not only are we going to cull here, but we want other countries to do the same thing. Why? Because we want to open up the ivory trade. If you open up the ivory trade, a lot of us will get richer faster. So this is the sort of reasoning that the people who believe in culling, this is the reasoning they give. Let's not go into it. If you people have if you're interested in it, you can go on the net and search why culling is used as a tool for conservation and what are the benefits and disadvantages. Or you can ask me later, I'll be here for you. But along comes a lady called Cynthia Moss. Now when the pressure comes on Kenya, Kenya is in Central Africa. When pressure comes on Kenya and the people from the south of Africa come and say, you've got 120,000 elephants in Tsavo National Park, they're going to destroy the forest. There's going to be drought. All these animals are going to die. Why don't you cull them? Why don't you kill 80,000 elephants? Oh, 80,000 elephants. The head of Kenyan Wildlife Service then was Mr. Leakey. And Leakey really was coming under severe pressure because killing 80,000 elephants meant a huge amount of income. So he really didn't know how to play his cards. So along comes Cynthia Moss, who's given the elephants to us. She's really given the social structure, the emotional behavior, the bonding of the elephants to humanity. She was a researcher in Amboseli National Park. She goes to Leakey and says, please spend a day with me in Amboseli. And I will tell you that I will try to teach you a couple of things about this animal and how human these animals are. Then you take a decision after that. So Leakey, being a great officer, says, of course, I'll come with you. So she takes him to Amboseli National Park. She stops in the middle of an elephant herd and she starts explaining about the birds and the bees, about elephant life, about how the sister and two sisters, mother and daughter, how the elephant society lives together and how they feel pain, how they feel remorse, how they feel happiness. And in some ways, they're pretty much like us. They have certain ceremonies also, like we have a ceremony where the boy and the girl gets married and then we dress them up, and there's 3-4 days of fanfare and hangama, and we're trying to get a word across or a message across to the girl and the boy that, listen, this whole ceremony is designed to prepare you for the act of marriage, because yes, there will be other issues which will come with marriage and we want you to be ready for it. So that's humans. That's how we do it in different cultures. Now elephants, they do pretty much the same thing. It's really amazing what Cynthia Moss discovered. What they do is that when the female elephant, and she comes into estrus every 4.5 years, estrus is when she's ready to get married. And when she comes into estrus for the first time, she's very nervous, she doesn't know what's happening, she doesn't know what it's all about. The matriarch will come, put her mouth, put her trunk in the female elephant's mouth and test for hormones. See if she's okay or she's very nervous. If she's very nervous, they will postpone it for another 4.5 years. But if she can pacify the female elephant and says, no, I'm ready, please, let's talk about this further, then at this point of time, about 4 or 5 male elephants will be going around the herd. One of them will be approved by the female. And when the little girl says, yes, I am ready to be married, the matriarch will select one of the big bulls, maybe he's in must, maybe whatever the reason, whatever their criteria for selection is. And that bull will be invited. The rest of the herd will be standing around the little girl and protecting her from other males. Very much like our society. And then when the big male comes, they are introduced together. And they found a bond, and at the time of marriage, the entire herd will turn their back to the couple. They will not look at the couple. And then after the act, there's rejoicing, there's screaming, there's shouting, there's breaking of branches, there's spreading the word that our little girl has got married. Now when Leakey heard all this, and he saw that, you know, elephants feel remorse because they come back to the bones of their ancestors, every year they go back to the bones of their ancestors, they shed tears because it's all on the same migratory path. My father passed away, I have to yet go back and say my prayers at the Baika tombs. I haven't gone back. I certainly can't go back once a year. I don't cry every year. So the elephants, then Cynthia Moss says, keeps the child in the stomach for 22 months. We keep it for 9 months. Their bond is far stronger than ours. Leakey says, yes, but you know, let's talk about it. She says, no, if you're still not convinced, let me take you across to Kruger National Park. Now, in Kruger National Park, can I have that? Vancouver National Park, you can see that it's a very long park, right? So it's actually 600-700 kilometers from the south to the north. On the right is Mozambique. And around in the south, somewhere there, there's a river called Crocodile River, and the culling operation was taking place there. The culling operation means that the helicopter will come and drive these elephants towards the line of hunters. Now, so what she did was, Cynthia Moss, every 50 kilometers on the western border of the national park, she placed a scientist, a jeep, a scientist, recording instruments, and cameras. And she said, just time what happens and when it happens. Just time it, photograph it, and tell us what happened. Don't create anything. Whatever happened, just report it to us. So they were ready. Every 50 kilometers, Cynthia Moss's team was ready. Leakey and Cynthia Moss were in the south. Culling operation starts. Helicopter comes. Elephant starts screaming, crying, shouting in trauma. And they come up to the hunters, and every one of them is shot down. Within 20 minutes, reports start coming in. Elephants all along the western border, up to 500 kilometers north, are terrified. They break the fence and they run. They're going berserk. They are traumatized. The entire herd of this national park, massive national park, maybe 100 times bigger than Bandipur, were traumatized. And Cynthia Moss says, have you accepted now that elephant population is far more human than any human society will ever be? And he said, but how is this happening? So she turns around and says, they talk in infrasound. And when an elephant rumbles, infrasound is like a bat is ultrasound. Then there is a sound that we hear. Infrasound is below our frequency of hearing. And when they talk in infrasound, the waves are shallow and they can travel longer distances. So an elephant up to 5 or 6 kilometers in a plane, not in the jungle, not in the deep jungle, but in the plane, and most of it is savanna, most of it is grasslands. In the plains, the word will carry to a different herd, then from you it will go to her, from her it will go to her, and within 20 minutes the entire elephant population of this national park was traumatized. So Leakey turns around to the South Africans and says, what's going on, guys? Can't you see what's happening? Oh, no, this is rubbish. These scientists don't know what they're talking about. We will continue playing God. Continue completely devastating the wildlife social structure of this beautiful national park. Anyway, it doesn't end there. Then she says, all right, let's go back to Kenya. And Leakey turns around and says, yes, but in Kenya, I have Tsavo National Park, which is on the east, southeast of Kenya, just north of Tanzania, where I work and where I live. And I have 120,000 elephants, and they're eating up everything. What's the solution to that? So she says, certainly not killing them. As you've seen, in nature, there is life and death, right? So if you die naturally, there is no trauma. There is, of course, remorse. There's massive remorse we've seen, like us. Like we feel sorrow. Elephants feel sorrow, other animals feel sorrow. But there's no trauma because it's died of natural causes. So in Tsavo National Park, she says, let things be. And conservation is only about letting things be with least interference. He says, how can I let things be? They'll die. She says, yes, of course they'll die. But see what happens. So they let things be in the Tsavo National Park. They ate up all the graze, they ate up all the trees, they destroyed the browse, they destroyed everything. And lo and behold, there was drought and 80,000 elephants died of natural causes. Now, where man earlier was saying that, you know, the carrying capacity of this national park is only 45,000, nature dropped the elephant population to 45,000-50,000. When 80,000 elephants died, they died of natural causes. They didn't die of trauma. And it doesn't stop here. This is after 10 years that they realized. What happened was that the females, which normally come into estrus or into marriage mode every 4.5 years, now, how nature did this, nobody, no scientist has an answer. But they doubled that time from 4.5 years to every 9 years, they started coming into estrus. And every 9 years meant that 22 months in the stomach, every 11 years, they were producing a child. They stopped the production of the cows. They limited it by half. Elephant population naturally settled down at 45,000, which is the carrying capacity. And Kenya turned around to the world and said, well, here it is. Don't ever interfere with nature. Please don't blame God, because you have no idea what you're doing. So Kenya, in order to prove to the world that they were not going to allow pressure from the wild, from the south get to them for ivory trade, they burnt their ivory. They burnt it twice. But they burnt it. Millions and millions of dollars of ivory trade were burnt by Leakey. And it just proved to the world that this is a country which is really fighting hard and striving for conservation. I'll also tell you, it's not just about elephants, it's about zebras too. How many of you have seen zebras? In the wild? Have you seen them in the wild or in a zoo? No, any of you. You, ma'am? You? In the wild? Who's seen them in the wild? Where?
One of the national parks.
Okay, great. So, even I used to guide safaris. I've been guiding safaris now for over 20, 25 years. And I used to see zebras in the wild and I would say, ah, what a beautiful animal. But no, when I actually started learning about the zebra, it's a fascinating animal. Now, scientists will never use the word love, but I will, because I've seen it. When a girl, a zebra, and a boy zebra get together, they have to like each other, I would say love each other, for them to tie the bond and get married. And that bond lasts for life. If she doesn't like him, she won't even go near him. He can try whatever he likes. Now they get married, and nature is organized in such a manner that what if they are married and he gets killed by lions? So then what he does is, nature for some reason allows him to take six wives, five or six wives. And it's normally six, it doesn't go more than that. But he just can't go and pick up a wife. That lady has to like them both. And the approval has to come from the lady zebra. So the first wife has to approve the second. Second, third wives have to approve the third. And this carries on. In the end of the day, they have these five, six ladies together who then form a bond, who will never leave each other. They become like blood sisters. And they will protect each other from lions. If one dies, they will take care of the calf of the other. And if the male dies, they might or might not take another husband. It is so fascinating. So wildlife is really fascinating, till of course we interfere. Two books which I have told ma'am that I will send to the school library. The first book is The Hidden Life of Trees, where if I pinch you, you will find pain and you will react instantly to pain. Those in biology will know why. Because pain in animals travels really fast. But trees feel pain. But the pain travels like in every 1 inch it travels, takes 4 hours or something. But they feel pain. Do they feel trauma? We have no idea. But that book is a must read, because that book will then open your eyes to what this world of what this living world is all about, what the ecobiosphere is all about. It means we have to protect the tree, we have to protect the animal too. The other one is, are we smart enough to know how smart animals really are? So the scientists came up with a term called umbeto, which means that humans have absolutely no idea what animals are thinking. So these two books, we'll get them in the library so that you guys can read it. I won't spend time on them. History of protection, before we, you must understand where forest management, wildlife, conservation, where all this comes into play. I've divided it into four, but actually what happens, it's pre-British, British and post-British, independent India. Pre-British, it was all the rulers, it was basically monarchy in India, different kings in different places. And when they would use, or when they would say have a large tract of forest, they would use the villagers, make them part of the forest to make sure that the forest is managed. They can take forest produce from it, they can take wood, they can take berries, they can take whatever forest produce they need. And in the end, they would then belong to the forest and they would conserve the forest. So that was a conservation move that most of the kings pre-British used. Along comes the Brits. And even if you go back before the Brits, whether it's the Mughals, whether it's Ashoka, whether it's Harsha, they came to India and they were part of this landmass. They didn't take it and go anywhere. Along came the Brits. They changed the entire law. They said, no, all these forests belong to the Crown of England, to the King of England. They don't belong to you, Mr. Reddy. They don't belong to you, ma'am. And therefore, the laws were established. Lines were drawn. This is the forest. Anything which comes over here, like treacle trees, rosewood trees, belong to the king, not to you. If you go into the forest, we'll kill you, we'll arrest you. So they were protecting their wealth. They were harvesting their wealth. So our forests became wealth for the Crown of England. So the laws that came up suddenly excluded these villagers. So the villager could now not find himself going into the jungle to pick up firewood, he'd get arrested. They used to make buttons out of antlers. Antlers would fall, which was wrong because a lot of other local animals actually eat those antlers. But they would buy that for buttons. They would use a lot of forest produce to survive. Suddenly, all that was gone. Conflict starts. But what can you do? If you say anything against the king, he'll kill you. So, during the British, the laws became very rigid, very exclusionary. It pushed you away. It didn't embrace you. Along comes 1947. We become independent. What do? We follow British laws. That 5,000-year-old culture of ours, the tradition of ours of involving the people of our country in order to protect our forests. And by the way, the forests belong to all of us in this room. Forests belong to every Indian. They don't belong to any official. They don't belong to a politician. They belong to you. You pay the official his salary. But the official doesn't look at it that way. He thinks he's God. He doesn't need you. He's not in dialogue with you. He doesn't need your respect. He needs the respect of his elders to grow. So post-1947, exclusion retains. British laws are not changed. They're changed in Kenya, they're changed in Tanzania, they're changed in Uganda. Conservation laws of the local country are established. In India, we don't change them. Further, what happens? 80% of our wildlife is killed in 10 years, in the 1950s. Why? Because earlier, during the British and before that, weapons, licensing of weapons or hunting used to be very controlled, heavily controlled by the power, by royalty or by the local DC of that area, or by the king or the princes. So, you know, people didn't get gun licenses. You couldn't go out there and kill any animal. And whatever you had to do, you had to take permission. Permission was not given. So a healthy carrying capacity of animals was maintained. Whether it was done on purpose or not, I don't know. But that's how it happened. 1947 onwards, 1951 onwards, every single person could now pick up a license. And they started taking hunting blocks. They wiped out 80% of our wildlife wealth. Just massacred it. Whose fault? Forget whose fault it is. It just happened. And then when Indira Gandhi, when she was the Prime Minister, she saved the world, the wildlife world. She protected it by giving us the Wildlife Protection Act. What did the Wildlife Protection Act do? The Wildlife Protection Act also just drew a line and said, you cross, it's an arbitrary line, just drew a line and said, that side is Forest Department. If you enter there, we'll kill you. You'll be a poacher or a smuggler. This side is you, revenue land, where you can grow your stock. But you cannot go into the forest. But if the animals come and if the tiger kills your cow, you kill the tiger, we'll put you in jail. But he's coming to my house. He's killing my cattle. And I can only afford one cow in all my life. He's killed it. And my compensation is nothing. No. You do anything, you poison the carcass, we'll put you in jail for 30 years. How is that possible? If you want to draw a line, then keep your animal your side. We'll keep ourselves this side. But we can't now go pick up wood. We can't pick up any forest produce. But you can, your animals can, elephants can come in 1 minute, destroy the entire field. And who is the tribal? You know the tribe, when they did a genetic test, our tribal girl, Raghu, which is the tribe that we had yesterday, we were discussing? Koyas, the Koyas or the Kurubas or any of these tribes. That's the first Indian lady in this on our continent. Suddenly, she's been here since God knows how many hundreds of thousands of years. Suddenly, you wake up and say, "Get up." And they say, trying to say, "Where can we go? We don't. The only life we know is how to live in these forests." And my friend Murli, he was the head of the chief of the area where I work. They would at night, they would just bend these branches and sleep under them. Some were naked. I'm talking about the 80s. "Get out. You're not part of the forest anymore. Where can we go? Oh, we'll give you a small little two by two house, and we'll give you 2 acres of land. Cultivate." "We don't know how to cultivate. We don't have money to cultivate." "No, no, cultivate. And if you cultivate, the wild boar will come and eat it. We can't kill the wild boar. We'll go to jail." "Yeah, yeah, you can't do all that." So there was a huge conflict which starts. Conflict is because of certain failures. In hindsight, I can say that yes, we failed these people, because they are the forgotten people of India. So there's a lot of failure that took place, and over time, that Protection Act should never have been the Wildlife Protection Act. It should have been the Wildlife Conservation Act, where the tribal should have been involved, the politician should have been involved, the bureaucrat should have been involved, the villager should have been involved in taking the decision. Okay, so conservation is a win-win solution for every living being. You, by the way, I don't know how many of you know this, but how many of you know that we are part of the animal kingdom? Raise your hand. 1, 2, 3. Okay, quite a few of you. We're animals. We're not, and it doesn't mean that we are animals because we are part of the animal kingdom. Do you know somewhere along the line, our ancestors actually mated with apes? We have 2% of ape genes in us. How and where that happened, none of us knows. We cross interbred with Homo sapiens, Homo erectus, Denisovans, and a lot of other subspecies of humans also interbred. Neanderthals. At the end of the day, Homo sapiens wiped them all out, which is us. But we are part of the animal kingdom. So when you look at conservation of any area, when you look at conservation of the Hyderabad Public School grounds, you have to have a win-win solution for you, the student, you, the teacher, you, the director, me, the conservationist who comes here, the little ant, the earthworm, the snake, the birds, the butterflies, the everything. You need to find a win-win solution for that entire ecobiosphere. Because if you don't, something will die. Okay? So I'm not going to go into further details. So I'm going to go into a straightforward question and answer session now. And if any of you have any doubts before that, please ask me. And I'll take you through it. But see, one of the other problems that we have in India right now is we have so many laws for the same thing. Like, we should have one law which coordinates all the bodies that control our air, our land, and our water. We don't. We've got this act, that act, this act. There are some acts which actually, like the Wildlife Protection Act says, get out of the forest. The Tribal Act, the Forest Rights Act says, no, go back into the forest. How can you have conflicting laws? So one of the things that I have written to the Prime Minister, I have written to the Chief Minister, I think Mr. Reddy carried the letter to the Chief Minister also, but we need a body to coordinate all these different acts and these different departments to have one common vision. That one common vision will decide what is good for conservation, what is not good for conservation. Yes, humans in a village, humans need the basic needs to be met, shelter, food, etc. Cattle need grazing. What's happened in my village? All the land of the area is given to humans. There's no place to graze for the cattle. Cattle either die of drought or they go into the national park. When the cow goes into the national park, it's eaten by a tiger. The tiger is poisoned. The tiger is killed. So there's a vicious circle of failure that takes place. Okay? All this we'll go into later, not now. And by the way, don't worry about when I talk to you and we're doing a question and answer, please don't worry about hurting sentiments, because these are contentious issues. The act of conservation is to get everybody, in the village, I'm talking about the village because that's 70% of our society. In the city, it's the same thing. Everybody on the table. And how do you get everybody on the table when in my village, my manager cannot go into 70% of the houses because he comes from a certain caste. So if he comes from a certain caste and he cannot sit on the same table as a person from another caste, how can you have a win-win solution? What have we done? Under the carpet. Don't address this. It's become a political vote bank situation. I'll get transferred. But we need to address it because everyone needs to talk together. We need to find a solution which is, whatever the barrier is, we have to find a win-win for that, for this, for this, for this. The rich will sit on the table, the poor can't talk. Why? Because the rich don't want to listen to what the poor says. What do they know? That's 80% of your country. So, the conflict, wherever there is conflict, it needs to be resolved, and where it needs to be resolved, there will always be contentious issues. If you keep pushing it under the carpet, 70 years later, we will land up where we've landed up, where basic fundamentals of being an Indian are not respected. It's terrifying. Think about it. So be Indian first. First thing my school taught me. Okay, I'm not going to get into this. I'm going to go straight into the... This takes a long time. Right, so tell me about the village. How many of you live in villages or have been to villages? To your parents' villages? You have? Okay, I need a girl also. Girls, yes. Can you please come here? And you also. Better handwriting. Come. What's your name? What's your sorry? Sanvi. And yours? Alright. Introduce yourself. And Sanvi, and right, so these two are going to be the compares. They're going to be standing here. I will be sitting down with Ms. Reddy. I want to be part of you boys and I want to be part of the solution. The challenge here is, and I want the answer to come from every single one of you. Please, ma'am, I want you to be part of it. I want you to be part of it too. And the career counselor is sitting here. At the end of this session, we're going to be talking to the career counselor. We will call her and we will ask her that these are the career opportunities which are available to you, all of you. If you want to be part of conservation, want to be part of life, there is a beautiful life there. Beautiful opportunities. You can be part of that. Even if you don't become part of that, even if you are like Ms. Reddy or if you're part of the administrator or the school principal or Mr. Satya Nadella, you can still be part of conservation. Never lose that in your heart. Take a little part of this with you, and even when you become like, you know, I can turn around and say, chief ministers, we've got two chief ministers from our school. Now, if the chief ministers have taken a part of this with them, they have been hardcore conservationists. I'm not saying they are not, or they have failed. No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that I would rather that they have known all this before they became chief ministers. One of you will be chief ministers, prime ministers, who knows? When I was 16 and I was with Raghu, I went to the Nets in Hyderabad, and there Mr. Abid Ali, who was the captain of under Mr. Jaisimha, he told me that, you know, sir, we cannot even think like being Gary Sobers or Donald Bradman. And I said to myself, why not? If I'm not going to dream of becoming Donald Bradman, why will I play cricket? But then I proved him wrong, because I was the only second person in India in school to get an international 100. Now, had I thought and I had accepted failure that no, I can't be Don Bradman, I will not be able to play these West Indians, I'd have run away. So, think big. You people can achieve. You have no idea how much you as the children of this school can achieve. We can dictate policy. We are so, so well positioned. We don't do it. We must do it. Alright, so first question. Ma'am there is, this one here. She is the mother of a child. Child is 8 years old. and it has been killed by a leopard and eaten, and he is hanging on a tree. This has happened in my life. Not to my child, but it's happened to a child. And you're the mother who's just lost the child. And all of you now need to give her solutions as to why we should not kill that leopard. He there has lost his father, killed by a tiger, in another village. And he's extremely upset, and he wants to go and kill, not one, kill all the bloody tigers over there. Now I need you to give him a solution, an answer, as to why we should not kill the tiger and why we should not kill the leopard. Okay, it has to come from you. Come, and you have to write it down.
Okay, who's going first?
Someone, anyone. Yes, sir.
She's asking me why she should kill it.
Why should we kill it?
Yes.
Rather, putting myself in your shoes, if I see that, when my daughter or my son is being killed by a tiger or any other animal, it's one thing where I should be like crossing my lines. Yeah, I should be instinctively. Where?
The tiger has crossed the line. The tiger has come to your house and killed you.
Now the house is this place is not find
No, sir, that's not the point. Okay, so see, you understand. I'm sorry, but we complicate it. I'm not finding fault with it. But we should not complicate the issue. The issue is very simple. I'm living in my village and the tiger has come and killed my child.
I can't do anything about that.
Right, come on guys, I know that there is a solution here. Come on, stand up, tell me, what would you do?
You see, the tiger, the wildlife, they won't, for no reason harm a person. Maybe it's their necessity, the food, they hunt for food. That's how the food chain works. They have to hunt. I as a human do not need to do it. It is okay. It has happened. I cannot go back and kill it because, you know, I must have the empathy. I don't know.
So, empathy. Please write down empathy. Please write down food chain. That's a beautiful answer. Thank you. Please write down nature, because that's what you said. That is natural. That for a tiger to survive, it has to kill, right? So that's the food chain, she said, and she said it's natural. Exactly. But now, are you happy with this? That you lost your child and I come to you as an officer and say, no, please empathize. Your son is part of the food chain and your son is eaten up by a tiger. Are you happy? No, she's not happy. It's not going to be enough for her. Come on, someone else. Come on, guys. Come on. Yes, please.
Sometimes it's a one-sided picture. So we do not know the child which was killed by some animal also had some suffering. Maybe like somebody attacked his own child. Like the child, the animals also have feelings, right? So we do not know at what point of time the animal was harmed and he was also in a feeling of revenge. Injured emotionally also, they also have emotions, right? Physically injured or emotionally injured, he's also feeling that, and he's attacking a human because he finds human as an enemy.
So an animal also feels emotion.
So the kind of hatred a parent is having, same as animal also is having, yeah. So we are unaware of that fact or the other side of the picture.
Maybe the animal was traumatized. Maybe maybe they have come from that. And therefore, he has to talk to that.
Yeah.
He hopes to talk to him.
Yeah, physical or mental, emotional, any kind of injury.
Maybe he was injured. Maybe he was injured because he was in a trap. Maybe he was shot. Maybe he could hunt his mother. So he was not able to hunt mom.
Yeah, the moment we see an animal, we find it as an enemy, and same way the animal may also see the human and find us as an enemy because of various reasons.
Fantastic. Absolutely. This is conservation. If you're going to find a win-win solution, you need to find an answer for her. You need to find an answer for him. You need to find an answer for the tiger, because the tiger also is a living being. Thank you, ma'am. The tiger also has emotions. The tiger also feels trauma. And by the way, your trap, which you set, people set traps or snares, has injured the tiger and he cannot hunt his normal prey. Maybe her husband or her father has injured the tiger. Who knows? And he is not able to hunt his normal prey. So, certainly, that these are very fundamental issues which have come up. Now, ma'am, this is what happened to the tiger. He was injured by some member of the village. He's not able to hunt. Are you happy that he's killed your child? She's still not happy. Yes.
Have a higher intellect than animals, then they can actually think and reason. So I think, what is the point of killing an animal just because he is killed in your life?
So we believe we are above the animal, we are actually higher than the animal. That's a absolutely. We believe that the animal and us should not be compared. Intellectually we are higher.
There's no point in killing an animal just because it has hurt her. It has hurt us.
And the animal is lower than us. So why take out our anger on it, even though it's eating a child? Okay? This is certainly a part of it. Okay. Thank you.
Sir, we can take preventive measures from what we have learned previously. So we can take preventive measures, sir, to prevent such attacks from animals in the future.
Take preventive measures. How?
Sir, from so one of them is you said set traps in one way. Yes, it may injure the animal, but there is a difference between self-defense and attacking. So yes, that's one of the measures we can take.
No, I think also what you're trying to say here, which is something that I have been fighting for, is if you're going to have a line and you're going to say that is forest and this is your private land, then stop your animal from coming out, no? Have fences. The only preventive measure that you can actually take is to have a fence, but the government does not want to have a fence. But is that the answer to her? Yes, preventive measure is there, but she's not happy, man. She has lost her child. Preventive measure has to be taken as part of protection. Agreed. Anything else?
No, sir, I cannot oppose the fact that she's sad for her child's loss. It's obvious anybody would be sad. The only, yes, obvious, have to take preventive measures, sir.
Sir, so I would like to take a different perspective. What if you're the tiger, you step into the shoes of the tiger and why would you come and kill a human? Because there isn't much game in the forest, there isn't much food, habitat loss. I'm pretty sure that we all, this whole land...
Habitat loss, no game in the forest, poaching, smuggling, because you as human are interfering with nature, taking over forest, deforestation. Please write all that down.
I'm pretty sure that for generations to come, before we settled into these lands, these lands were occupied by other animals, isn't it? So they're just following their natural instinct. And another way to look at it is...
One second. Keep that thought. Don't. Corridors. Wildlife corridors. He's saying that those lands were occupied by other wildlife. So, wildlife corridor. Right?
Yeah. Another thing is, suppose you killed the tiger's child. Will the tiger come behind you and maliciously hunt you down? No. It won't do that. It'll just go on with the circle of life, isn't it?
So is that the point that she made?
Yeah.
That if you kill the tiger's child by... Exactly. In the national park, one of the problems we have is accidents on the roads. On the roads, we have so many deaths. So if you run over a tiger's child, will it ask for revenge? We don't know. National park, roads, conflict, run over a tiger's child. Yeah? Point same.
So basically, lions and tigers are very pride-driven creatures. They don't come out of their area. They have like an area there. They have a particular area where they hunt. Or they won't come out of that area until it's very necessary for the survival. So it's only done when their ecosystem is disturbed.
Ecosystem disturbed.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Absolutely. Something you said also, I think.
Yeah.
The tiger has territories.
A tiger is a territorious animal and is solitary in nature. So if anything that enters into its territory, it will consider it as...
So what he's saying is that the tiger has come out of his territory because his territory has been disturbed by humans.
Habitat loss,
exactly. Yes. Absolutely, so it creates new territory. We've got that problem everywhere. Okay? Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't want to stop you. Carry on. She has to write it down. Anything else?
Yeah, keeps changing, and if we just start, encroachment of forests, which pushes these animals to different locations, and it doesn't really help.
Encroachment. Come on. Anyone? You worries? Some more? Anyone else? Yes.
Sir, I would like to elaborate on her point, what Sarah told, that we are superior to animals only because of our intelligence. I would say that she should be happy instead of being sad. It is this basic situation that a child, a mother is going to be happy, sad if her child dies, if she is killed by someone. Yes, but everything happens for a reason. Tiger came out of the area because the tiger's territory was captured by humans itself, right? So, I would say happy. She should be happy. Everything happens for a reason.
She should be happy that she lost her child.
No, not because she lost. I wouldn't.
You're trying to say something, but
she should accept it. She should just accept it.
She should accept it.
Right? She should.
Acceptance. Why is there no acceptance? That's by the way.
I actually used the wrong word. No. I should replace it by accepting instead of happy.
You got to the right word because you got to the heart and soul of conservation. Acceptance.
Yes, sir.
Why did she not accept it?
Thank you.
Yes.
Sir, personally, Saad said that we are superior to animals because of our intelligence. Now, that is a belief because we base the animals' intelligence based on how it obeys us, how it accepts us and follows our commands. If we don't judge the animal based on its own intelligence, we try to judge it based on our intelligence. Our ability to accept orders is what we judge the animal by. So, it's wrong to say that animals, we as humans are
animals. He said that humans think we are superior. You know that book I showed you where animals.
How we see them, how they accept us.
So, human values and attributed to animals. Right? Human values cannot judge animals. And we are in no way superior to animals. No way. Okay, anyone else? Because there is, yes, go for it.
It had been told that the government is not ready to build a fence. Is it true?
Sorry?
You had informed that the government is not ready to build a fence.
Government is not ready to build a fence.
Yeah.
The government is not ready to build a proper fence.
Okay, so I think we should, the family and the people association should pressure the government to take the necessary measures.
So, basically what you're saying is, why don't we fight for our rights?
Yes,
why doesn't the Indian stand up and demand what his right is?
Yes.
India doesn't do that. So, demand for your right. And your right, one of the rights is protection. Correct?
Yes, sir. And sir, if we are to assess it from bottom up, we have to consider the fact that we are also a part of nature. So, the fact that we want to kill the animal, like the tiger would not be having a debate about as to if he should kill the person or not, right? So, if we are to look it from that point of view, it is natural for us to want to kill the tiger. So, it's not something really, you know, outlandish, I should point that out.
So, I'm coming to that. So I'm actually going to lead to the next question based on what he says. Thank you. Alright, so the next challenge now, the first thing is, that no matter what I put on the board, she is not happy. She has lost her child. There is no way that you can give an answer with today's existing exclusionary structure to please this girl or to please this boy, this mother and this father. It doesn't exist in our system. But now, let's think of a system where it does. What we now go into is that let's go into another country, in a country where she as a villager has a right in what happens to the forest. She as a villager will dictate, will have the chief conservator of forest, will have the chief minister, will have the president, will have the range forest officer respecting her, will come down and talk to her as an Indian. Will be forced to debate with her, will be forced to be in dialogue with her, not only her, with him and every Indian there is in that area or every human there is in that area. So now she becomes part of what happens to the forest. Her society, her mother, her daughter, her grandmother, his family, his society, his schoolmates, all of them now are part of finding the solution for what happens if a tiger comes out. And Murli gave me that situation. Murli, the tribal leader I was talking about, he told me, sir, when you left us in the forest and we had to decide how to handle ourselves with the tigers and the man-eaters and the elephants which killed us and the snakes which killed us, we knew how to do it. And if they killed us, it was part of nature, we accepted it. There was no trauma. There was no conflicting line. They were part of the forest. So, belonging, just right over here, below the line. So below the line, now we're going to discuss what happens if she and he and all of you belong to the solution. You are giving that solution. You cannot turn around and say, that forest department fellow is responsible or the law is responsible. You are the one who created the law, you are the one who handles the forest, you are the one who does the forest, handles the forest fires, you are the one who handles water in the forest. You are the one who handles, make sure that there is no poaching, because you as part of the villager will not allow him to kill an animal. Because if he kills animals, you are going to suffer. Right? So you are part of the one who is going to turn around and say, don't cut those trees. Because you are telling the same villager or the villager from outside, or even if some politician comes, you are not allowed to cut these trees. Because if you cut the trees, my village will not get rain. You are part of the problem where you turn around and say, that yes sir, we need to maintain fire lines or we need to maintain certain areas which are free from certain hazards. Okay, you are looking into grazing. You are saying that yes, we should look into grazing outside national parks. Only species should we be allowed to go in where there is grazing. So you will make sure that there is enough grazing for all the cattle of your villages. You will ensure that there are enough deer and sambar for the tiger to kill. Now, if you are responsible for all that, and you are part of the forest management, and you are responsible for what you do, what your child does, and what the tiger does, now is there an answer? Because now when the tiger kills a child, the entire society around her, all the villagers, her sister, her brother, his family, are going to sit down on the same table, with everyone, without any barriers, and say, right, we're sorry it happened to you, but where did we fail? Because she failed, he failed, all of us failed. And the moment the solution is given to us, the moment where we belong. The moment we belong, and that forest belongs to us, that tiger belongs to us, the solution is on the table. So you will feel sorrow. Like Murli, the tribal leader, you will feel sorrow, you will feel great, like the elephant child which is killed, like the tiger's child which is killed, you will feel a great sorrow. But you don't want revenge. Because the tiger is part of your life. He is like your neighbor. So that is conservation. Understood? We did the same thing yesterday with the youngsters. You have that list with you? Huh? I just want to read out the list. This list, how old were they yesterday? Huh? Grade 8 is how old? Ma'am, can you read this?
Sacrifice.
This is coming out of 8-year-olds, 13-year-olds. Okay. Sacrifice.
No gain without pain.
No gain without pain.
Hope.
Hope. And just underline.
Struggle. Overpopulation.
There.
Sympathy and empathy.
Is there? Empathy is there. Empathy.
Love and care.
Love and care is there.
Compassion.
Compassion.
Family. One question with many answers. You have ego on top.
Ego. A big ego on top.
Ego.
They said that we should put ego really big words.
And then the other side was protesting.
Yeah, they said protesting.
All our friends. Yes. Trust.
Trust.
You help those who are struggling.
Help those who are
struggling.
You help the weak. You help those who struggle.
Responsibility.
Responsibility.
Humanity. Humanity. Social obligation.
Social obligation.
Belonging.
Belonging.
Be who you are in a community.
Be who you are in a community. Community.
Community respect. See, I'm going to say something here which, sir, can you come forward please? Can you come next to me? Not finding fault with him, but
with any of the people sitting in the front row.
See, we've done what we can. We've done whatever we can to save this country. We've done whatever we can to destroy this country. At the end of the day, we didn't have answers. These answers that came on the table They didn't come, except for ma'am, who said something. The rest of the answers have come from you. We have failed. The biggest problem is that we have not learned from the failures. Because the failures are so big, we've hidden them. I don't want any of you to fail your society, to fail your school, to fail your country, to fail your people, to fail the poor, to fail your animals. Because every one of you today is in a position to do something. Think about it. You don't have to be like me, dedicated 40 years. You can. I mean, you'll have maybe the best happy moments of your life in the bush. I mean, I think I've been the happiest. I don't want to be Bill Gates, even if I wanted to be, but I think I'm much happier. Because the people I've worked with, the happiness that I've got is great. And the study of happiness is called logotherapy. There's actually a study of happiness. On study of happiness, I'm 10 out of 10. Because I tried. I'm not frightened of failure. And I love my wives. And more than that, I think every one of us humans is equal. I'm Indian first. And that's the challenge in front of us children. That no matter what you're taught, where you're taught, what your brainwashing is, and brainwashing happens in every place in the world, end of the day, think what this school taught you. We're all one. This is my brother that I live with. We're not from this, nothing of ours is common. But I love him because he's my classmate from school. Sacrifice. All these things that you see over here, all these points that you see over here, ma'am, you need to take a picture of this. This is conservation. Put everything together. Put people on a common platform. We can do it. Right now I can put all of us on a common platform, we'll talk because of the school. You can't do it in the village. You have to fight for that common platform in a village. You have to ask for your rights. Okay, I'm not saying be extremists. I'm saying know your legal rights. Understand them and be there for the animal, be there for the villager, be there for yourself. Don't let anyone ever corrupt you. Because corruption is the biggest challenge that our country faces. Do not become corrupt. Because the moment you become corrupt, you're gone. Okay? Do we have time? It's over. Thank you so much, children. Thank you so much, Board of Government. You are the board members, faculty. But thank you very much, sir, for being here with us. You and I don't have answers, but they have the answers. So I'm actually talking to the board members and the faculty so that you children can then go and build your own birding room where you can dictate, where you can actually log in how many birds come here, the number of snakes we have, reptiles we have. And for one last, okay guys, you go. One last thing, I'd like ma'am to come up. Can you come up, please? As a career move, what can you do? Ecotourism, fantastic ma'am. Ecotourism is... quickly, we'll do a quick career move on what all you can do. These are questions which I have not even asked you. But we can start here. You can be a naturalist, a guide. You can work in the bush. You can train in India or you can train in Zimbabwe. They train the best guides in the world. You can work in the forest and earn a very good living. You can be a camp manager. Camp manager gets anywhere between $5,000 to $7,000 a month, which is a fantastic pay. Camp manager is where you live your life in the bush, address all the conflicts and make that camp. Photography, I've got Shah's Jung. I don't know if any of you heard of Shah's? No, you haven't. Shah's Jung is a photographer who's a filmmaker, director, photographer, who's taken up wildlife photography as a career and he's doing exceedingly well. You can set up equine rescue centers, medical rescue centers for the villagers, veterinary centers for animals. You can work with NGOs, you can work with government, you can work with politics, veterinary services. You can become bush pilots, flying in the bush. You can become archaeologists. You can become, you can go into education. Bush doctors, you can dedicate your life to becoming bush doctors. Vocational training is huge. You can just become vocational trainers where you create an alternate source of revenue for the villagers. So there's this huge opportunity available.
I think I'll start with what I told you in the beginning that I should have said yesterday. See children, you all have sorted out careers or you are looking at planning something which goes through your education and all. And these things do require education, like we had an awareness session today and that's not a complete education. If you look at a simple example of going for a holiday, you plan something which is closer to nature. Right, we go there where we are undisturbed by man and we have more of wildlife which doesn't harm us, that's our plan of action. But looking at simple examples of our school, we have so many beautiful birds and peacock early in the morning when you come and see, and we all like it. So we like all what is original and natural, but we are going away from that. And at the end of the day, whatever you do, whatever career you make, you will go back to nature because you will be annoyed of what is all man-made. Enough of technology, definitely you are going to find out a place where you can be away from your gadgets. So the idea behind all such careers, maybe the mainstream careers or maybe something which you pick up alongside what you plan to do, is you have kindness in you, right? The way a man or a human plans to attack upon an animal, the animal doesn't plan, it just attacks back to prevent himself, right? It's not, he's planning that today I have to go there and attack it, man. We have so many reasons to do so. So we need to have kindness, whether you're going for a career or not. You need to take along the fact that it's not only the planet for us, it's for rest of the species also. We are one of them, and man thinking that we are somebody unique and somebody intelligent, we are wrong. The other day I had gone into their class, the same class sitting here, and I happened to say to them that please do not behave like humans, behave like animals, they are better than you. So the animals, the kind of qualities we see in them, we need to learn so much from them. So these offbeat careers, if we may call it, or the things which we have surplus, we are lacking the resources in that, if I'm right. There are less number of people into it and there's more of demand.
That's true, but you know, there's just everyone's going to have their own truth, even with conservation. Each one of them will have their own experiences.
Yeah. So, feeling the sensitivity that why it is needed and what harm we have already done, which is irreversible, I think, which cannot be...
We don't have answers. I think the problem is we don't have answers. We
have lost so many types of animals which will not come back. But when we look at the news, we see, okay, this number of tigers are left in this particular place at all. I think we should be sensitive enough to this point that you shouldn't do any harm, whether you take it as a career or whether you just accept it as a human being, which is very much needed. And when we look into the depth of such careers, obviously we have not much information.
Any of you like to speak on this? Any of you like to say anything? Anyone feels the need to express themselves? Because these are careers, I think, these are career opportunities which are available to you. Alright, even if you have questions down the line. Raghu? No? Sir?
Hearing all this, say the conservation has become so important, we need to conserve. One small thing I want to share with you guys. How many of you have seen a small sparrow sitting in front of your house? Hello? Down in my time, used to have n number of sparrows. It's called that small sparrows. You know, plenty. It used to be like, you know, the group it used to fly around. Now, we rarely see one or two. Extinction. It's, now, if you don't conserve, it's going to die down.
But what did you do?
sir.
What have you done?
Now, I have put...
No, you meaning what has... We are standing here giving lectures. We are standing here giving lectures to these kids. Sparrows have died because of us. So what have you done in your life to save the sparrow?
Sir, that's what I want to say, sir. Now, in my house, I have around 10-12 pots that I set for them to come and nest and move. So I have around, I can see every day, I can see at least 20-30 sparrows coming and sitting in my window.
No, that's not the answer, I would say. Answer is that we stand here in front of you with your permission. We've done nothing, I'm sorry, to save your world. And if you don't do anything, this world will be lost. Yes, he has a story, she has a story, I have a story, he has a story. But these are just stories. I'm sorry, sir, I don't agree with you. We have failed the sparrow, we failed the land. All right, kids? But if our failure, we're not going to learn, that's us, ego. But through our failures, you learn. Thank you.
I stand here devoid of words because I've had an incredible ride in the last 2 days. And I know that all good things must come to an end. But ironically, this isn't the end. It's just the beginning for us. Sir has sensitized about wildlife, so we begin to love it. Human beings generally have a tendency to save what they love. It's not whether animals will survive. It's whether man has the will to save them. Undoubtedly, we all must remember that we don't own this planet. We belong to it, and we must share it with wildlife. We ought to spread the message that if you like to shoot an animal, do it with a camera and not a gun, as our wildlife needs our help. The life cycle of every species is intertwined. Today, if you hunt them, tomorrow they will haunt you. On behalf of the teachers and students of HPS, I thank you, sir, for taking out your important time and sharing your thoughts with us on a topic so dear to you. It's remarkable to know that the efforts you've taken to conserve wildlife and address the issues of the local tribal community. It's truly inspiring for us interacting with you, and we hope you enjoyed your time with us too. I now request Mr. Raghuram Reddy to honor Nawabzada Saad Bin Jung with a memento as a token of gratitude.
The wrong page.
So enthusiastically, thanks to the Office of Alumni Relations for this lifetime memory, and thank you everyone for being a part of this gathering.
Thank you. All right,
thank you.
Anyone has any questions, speak to her and